In terms of the flooding itself, it's important to point out that it wasn't extreme weather events, and the reason that we undertake these investigations is because of the number of properties that suffered internal flooding. And that's a key point, because I know a number of members through our members of the public have said that a lot of flooding took place that might not be represented in there, which was surface water flooding and such like. And I'll explain as we go through the investigation how we had to ignore those matters, but it was actually the internal flooding to properties. The commission itself was the report was undertaken by ACOM, who are experts in the field, and they split the investigation into four key tasks. The first task was to review the flood events itself. So this required ACOM to obtain and analyse rainfall and river level data from all partners involved in flooding and the local flood authorities and responsible authorities. And they talked about return period. It's important to understand how drainage systems cope during these flood events and whether the flooding caused was as a result of design standards being exceeded. So design standards of the existing sewage and water network that's designed to take away flood or water in events of rainfall and such like. In addition, a flood defence consent for temporary crossing on the Arrowbrook itself was also in place and reported in the local. And again, we asked within this flooding investigation for ACOM to review all data related to that crossing. And I'll come back to the findings of that later on in the presentation. Task 2 talked about identifying flooding locations, the types of flooding and causes of flooding, so whether that be river flooding, coastal flooding or surface water flooding. And in undertaking that, all risk management authorities were represented in a flooding debrief in September, were contacted, and they all freed up their resulting data to combine that into a single data set, which allowed this flooding investigation report to be a comprehensive investigation into what actually occurred on those dates. Task 2 also required ACOM to undertake site visits to verify flooding information, and in terms of that, they visited a number of properties and spoke to residents and a number of people who were affected by flooding as part of that. Task 3 of the investigation required a review of the Flood Risk Management Agency's actions, and again, this considered the actions of those either taken on the day or on the days of those flooding, or the ones not taken, and to comment back on those in terms of a timeline and what they would be expected to see. Again, I'll cover those in terms of the recommendations and findings of the report. And then the final part of the report talks about laying out some recommendations for all those partners to undertake so that we can use this piece of information and take the learning from it and review and revise any arrangements or any new sources accordingly to ensure that if we do suffer flooding with this type of gear, we'll be in a better position to be able to deal with it and take on board those. So section 3.8 of the report picks up the findings of the report, which is on page 5, and I'll take you through a number of those bullet points if I may. Obviously there'll be an opportunity for questions at the end, sure, if that's okay. But in terms of the first bullet point there, the assessment of rainfall that fell in two pulses on the 1st to 2nd September equated to a rainfall rarity of a 1 in 84 chance. In essence, what that means is there's a 1.2% chance of occurrence in any one year. I know that can be sometimes quite difficult to explain, but what it's trying to say there is this is an extreme weather event that could happen again, but it's a rare event. And the important point to bear in mind there is that as a guide for the Water Industry Act, sewers are designed to cope to a minimum of 1 in 20 return year period, so the actual amount of water that fell in terms of those frequencies, it overpowered the existing designed sewer systems in place. It's also important to note there was no rainfall data made available for the 22nd of August event. In speaking to the Met Office around this, they didn't have that information to have and weren't able to provide it. So there was no specific rainfall data for that event. The Met Office themselves, in terms of predictions of rainfall, in terms of the September event, just again to show that one of the findings of the report is that all the agencies that work around managing and preventing flooding are tied into national weather national weather alert systems. And in terms of those predictions for the event that happened so intense that they haven't even picked it up in terms of the Met Office themselves. In addition to that, the Environment Agency Flood Warning Service of Water is triggered by river levels measured in Brisbane, and this trigger level was not reached on the 2nd of September, and accordingly, therefore, no warning was issued for water as a result of that. I'll go on again about what they've done to change that in terms of as we take it forward. The Environment Agency did issue a flood alert for the Birkin catchment at 14:26 on the 2nd of September, when the trigger level of the Great Culvert of Binston was reached. But those who were out on the ground will be aware that by 14:26 there was also already a lot of flooded properties out there, and therefore it was a little bit late if that's the case. The report then goes on in terms of the findings to raise findings of a couple of particular issues and explain why that was the case. So again, flooding at East Greensby, at East Greensby, Joan Avenue, Greensby Road. This has been identified as being caused by a combination of surface water, overland flows, and the exceedance of the surface water network as a consequence of the high intensity and volume of rainfall which I mentioned earlier on. The flooding at Central Greensby, Grimby Drive, Howell Avenue, Lloyd Avenue, and Road was caused by a combination of surface water, overland flows, and again exceedance of the sewer network. Flooding at West Greensby, Rowan Close, was caused by a blockage on surface water sewer and the capacity of the ordinary water course being exceeded. And then flooding in Morton has been subject to further hydraulic modelling by both the Environment Agency and the United Utilities to determine the likely effect of the consented aerial crossing downstream. These models we were very keen to get reviewed by ACON, and they concluded that the flooding was caused by high river levels as a consequence of a backwater effect due to high river levels further downstream in the River Birkett. At Morton, high river levels exceeded the bank capacity needed to fluvial flooding and also caused water sewers to be unable to discharge. Additionally, rainfall intensity and volume caused the capacity of surface water network to be exceeded. So you know, they've answered that. The bullet point at the bottom is important just when we get on to, if you like, business continuity matters. The North Cheshire Trading Estate occurred due to the capacity of the overseas of the water course of the Brenton Brook. And the knock-on effect of this was that bad mutters, our highways contractor, who would normally be called on to assist us in response to civilians, their depot, their operational depot, was the other side of that flooded water. So we had situations where the staff couldn't get in to the depot, and they were hitting their business continuity arrangements to try and get resources brought in from their other depot in Cheshire. In total, 73 properties are verified as having experienced internal flooding on the 2nd of September, with 57 locations of external flooding, and 138 flooding reports remain unconfirmed. A critical infrastructure in the form of key transport links were also affected, and that information was captured as part of this investigation as well. Section 3.9 of the report on page 6 captures some of the recommendations to improve the response to flood risk during these events. These wide area recommendations apply to various risk management authorities and are detailed in full in the Section 19 report, but they can be summarised in those bullet points before. Underneath. One is about improving communication and encouraging residents to report flooding issues, and that's very important as we move forward. Really do try and encourage and change this perception among some residents that in reporting flooding incidents that may blight their property or cause them problems around insurance later on, it's really important that we get the message out there that they need to report those into the agencies so that that information can be captured and actually be used to inform future direction on resources against protecting against the flooding in the future. Investigate capacity change in Wirral's call centre. So there was very much an issue that the public were trying to ring into the Wirral's call centre and to receive advice on flooding. The Wirral's call centre at the time was overloaded with those calls coming in, and there's now very much a piece of work underway to link when we have a flooding incident of this kind to actually make use of the EA's floodline direct service, so we actually bolster the council's call centre capacity by having us switch over to a national support service who will field those calls for us. We need to ensure recording systems. accurately capture flooding details. We need to work with communities to improve awareness of flood risk, and again, this is a key part of the Section 19 report going forward in terms of the action plan. We need to do a lot more work with communities who are indicators of already experienced flooding in the past, or those that could be experienced flooding by the risk of where their property is, and work with those to either advise them and assist them where possible in terms of hardening their individual properties, but also to engender some community response itself in terms of that flooding, so that those people on the ground will know where. I call it this trusted friend, this good neighbour type arrangement, where they can take care of and look at some of those people who are more vulnerable in those areas whilst waiting for the responding agencies to get there. That's not to absolve the responding agency duties, but obviously they're people who are hopefully there in that community and will know a little bit more. We need to develop local flood groups to ensure flood risk is better understood, which is very much linked to that other matter around working with communities. We need to review the flood forecasting arrangements for Morton, and the Environment Agency have already moved the gauge for the river there further upstream towards Morton. So again, hopefully that will give us an earlier indication. And those river gauges from the Environment Agency, those levels are available to be viewed online by any residents in terms of monitoring those water levels. We need to investigate and identify sewer capacity issues where they've been presented. I've already explained about the design criteria for most of the surface water flooding that's a lot less than the events of these. If climate change is taking effect where we have more increased occurrences of high intensity weather systems and flooding, then we need to look at areas where we can design some capacity into that system that allows us to deal with that risk. And that's us as a partnership, not us as just the council. We need to improve contingency planning, particularly with North Cheshire Drain Estate. Again, a piece of work that needs to be there is both, we've also got not only our own contractors on the North Cheshire Drain Estate in terms of that nuttall, but those who know that area will also be aware that there's a Scottish Power control room in that situation, in that location as well. And again, they've been in conversation with us about what we can do to try and avert the fact that if a flood occurs, their staff will be kept on one side, not able to get into work, and that's an important consideration again as we move forward. We need to investigate and encourage the implementation of sustainable drainage through the planning process. Now, requirements under the new legislation for flooding to be a statutory consultation on planning applications for large major schemes, and as part of that, the drive about the developers actually putting in place sustainable, considering sustainable drainage with solutions that will manage the drainage to a far more to a warning term frequency, which is a lot less than what's there now. So new developments, major developments going in, will have to ensure that they've got a suitable consideration for arrangement of how to deal with water in those areas. We need to increase the take-up of property level protection. Increase the take-up of property level protection. Again, we were a little bit disappointed, Chair, in that we through both the local politicians, the MPs, and through the officers, we made representation with government to allow Wirral and the properties that were affected by this severe weather event to be included in the flood support measures that were offered to the affected properties from Storm Desmond and Eva that went on at the same time. This was something that had occurred in the new Brighton Skirling floods in 2013-14, where each affected property was in effect given an opportunity to draw down £5,000 worth of funding to undertake protective measures against their property. But that had been turned down on two separate occasions, and we're going to continue to push that. And I know the leader of the council said that he would like to write to the minister, appropriate minister, to ask that again. So, and then the final bit is about prioritising investigation for repeat flooding locations. So again, through the structures and through the partnership where we've got, we're very much keen to ensure that where there are repeat locations, that we're doing as much as we can to understand what causes that flooding and what are the measures that we put in place sponsored resource and implications in section 6. I've mentioned about the need to investigate the capacity of the change to the contact centre, and then community fluid groups. We need to build on the measures that came from the online questionnaire about the lack of understanding around flood risk and improving community resilience work. So it was really interesting in some of that follow-up work. We spoke to residents out there and said, what are you familiar with flooding? Are you familiar? And even some residents who've experienced flooding said they don't know anything about it and don't know what to do in events of that. So we really need to build on this in terms of knowledge we give to those residents about what they can do to, one, try and protect themselves, and two, make themselves more resilient against those situations. And really, Chair, that was it. I just want to be, before I answer any questions, to go to recommendations, which was that we're asking the overview committee to note the findings of the report to each relevant risk management authority, to note the recommendations in the report to allow Will Council as the lead local flood authority to improve the response with regard to flood risk management, and note the issue of the flooding investigation report to the public in accordance with the statutory requirement under section 19 of the Flood and Water Management Act. Happy to answer any questions.
Right, thank you for that, Mark. I'd like to open this up to the committee for questions and comments.
Thank you, Chair. Not getting into the climate change debate, but assuming that obviously we're going to experience more freak occurrences in the future, just when we put likely occurrences next to events like this, and obviously the 184, obviously that's based on past data, isn't it? So if we're looking to have more and more of these events in the future, maybe sometimes we need to take those with a bit of a pinch of salt, so the risk might be higher than it perhaps when it first appears. Obviously, whenever we do risk and risk management, it's always risk time and impact. So obviously, these are high impact events. So although they're very small risk, obviously the impact on our residents is obviously very high. So we need to take these seriously and see what we can do to make improvements. I was just wondering how we got, what sort of time scale we've got to both get a project plan and what we're going to do to tackle some of these issues. I mean, obviously, it's at early stages of the management of the report back, but when are we going to be sort of in a better position? Is this winter, are we going to be ready, or is it going to be years off? Time scale.
Chair, yeah, through you. Yeah, really, really good point, Chair. The issue over when return periods and I think it's a very, personally, I think it's a very confusing message that we try and put out to the public. That they're the frequencies and the formulas that are given to us by both DEFRA and the Environment Agency in terms of representing return rates for flood events and such like, and also you'll see the tightness of the design criteria for the infrastructure as well. So I take that on board, and that's why I put the 1.2% rate, is to try and give you a flavour for how what an exceptional event that was at that time. In terms of the work plan, hopefully members will be comforted to know that we've already started working on a number of the recommendations throughout that report. There is a work plan that's been drawn for the recommendations of that report, and they will be driven through the operational flood group and reported through. And I know the Chair's got something to say about this in terms of going forward, but there is a second paper on here that talks about the tiers of governance that it will go through and oversight, but obviously the Chair sit on our laurels, we're trying to address these points they come through. Chair, just if I made it's just important to mention one thing now. Some of these we've asked the recommendations to be split into quick wins, medium and long term. And I think it's important to point out to the committee really that some of the engineering solutions in terms of how we go about addressing those of an engineering solution is what is deemed required to address the risk. And they need to be presented to all of the agencies, flood risk agencies, because we need to be able to influence the various work programmes that are in place, because invariably these lead to quite high capital expenditure to undertake some of these improvements. Not all, but some.
Yeah, just on the timescales, my main point with the timescales are obviously we're nearly back around again to August the 22nd, it's nearly a year on, so assuming these are free. So it's not going to happen again back on that date. Are we going to have any of this in place by, you know, this winter, when there's more chance of heavy rain?
Yeah, Absolutely. In terms of some of the things in the quiver that we've done, we're just about to put it. So one of the things that was mentioned in there is about satellites. So that's something we can do relatively quickly, and we're looking to buy a stock of, not satellites, but a modern equivalent of satellites, so that we have them in place. We're working with our highways contractor about how we deploy those. We've also done work, I mentioned about the environment agency, and moved their brigades further up the line. There's work being done by the Met Office in terms of their warning and hazard management, which is the agency's Met Office providing tool for forecasting weather, is getting better time on time. So there are a number of things that are taking place which allow us to increase our warning to individuals that they're likely to experience flooding in a particular area. But some of the engineering solutions will require far more insight. And an important point to mention is that one of the things that Neil's working on commissioning through the Environment Agency is a full hydrological survey, if you like, across Wirral that shows the interdependencies and the interrelationship between surface water fluid, rivers, drainage systems, etc. We haven't got that, so we need to get that piece of work done as well. So there's a big beat put into the Environment Agency already to try and get some of that up running as soon as we can. Thank you. Chris?
We're told not to talk about our own board.
Can you use the microphone, please? Thank you.
I'm scrutinising your report, so I can only do it from what's in there. And you've kind of made reference to the fact that I've already been in touch. So if you look on page 6, it says, ensure recording systems accurately capture flooding details. Now, I gave to you in the report on the 2nd of September that we have an area of flooding in Beddington. It was also flooded in August. It's been flooded many times since. Nothing seems to be done. And I have emails that tell me it's caused by a combination of surface water and the exceeding sewage, etc. That's what we've been told. Now, had there been any money coming, £5,000, my residents wouldn't have got it because they're not in this report. And I don't understand why. I know I've got some answers, but I think we filled all the criteria of all these other places. Our residents use sandbags, they provided their own, they help each other. We have one resident who has a wheelchair that he can walk, so we cannot have that high piece of metal going on the door of a double glazed door because he can't step over it. Now, I just want to know, and I want to put on record, that myself and my fellow councillors, Walter Smith and Jerry Williams, are very concerned that despite us reporting this all the time, it still hasn't come out in this report. We know that you have tried to do some things about it. We understand that. But what we're concerned about is if we are not in your report, we might not be able to get money. And we don't care about you might not. We want to be in that report so if there's any chance of money, our residents get it. Because their flooding was as great as everybody else's.
Chair, thank you, Councillor Muspratt. Yeah, I am aware of the roads. I know the emails are coming. There isn't every, in the report, there isn't every flooded property mentioned in the report. But there is, in the report, an agreement, actually, a way forward that says all those reports that come in will be investigated in terms of where they're called. In terms of that, they will. In terms of if they've suffered or experienced internal flooding as part of these two weather events, then if their details have been reported in there, then if we are successful, they will go forward with a batch of properties that have experienced internal flooding, and therefore I'm right in saying that they will be eligible for that money if we get that money and if they flooded on these flood events.
Right, well I have to come back and say that you had to find it, didn't you? It wasn't there initially, and then you found that they had reported it on the 2nd of September by a licensed government office. point out the fact that there's no delivery on the road at the point in Cuttermish Ward, at the point where there's flooding. So that negates that one. And I'm worried, I want everybody who's eligible to be in this report. And I think the residents of Baker's Road in Bedlington need to be in this report as an addendum. Because they are suffering flood damage all the time. And every time it's heavy rainfall, and I think my colleague, Councillor Sullivan, mentioned about the time when Bedlington had a terrible amount of rainfall, Bedlington and Cllr Joe Walsh in that bit of Bedlington that we share, which where the rest
those properties that are repaired for those riparian properties. You write in new flood and water management act, the environment agency have permissive powers around maintenance. So the people who border onto rivers and their rivers have a responsibility to protect that infrastructure that borders onto those rivers, and that's in place. So that's the legislation as it is, and that's it. But that's what the environment agency do. In terms of the community, I tried to allude to it as when I was giving my report beginning. It's exactly that type of community engagement that I want to get out of the work around, not just about having flood wardens and such like, but also there's some communities who are willing to undertake some of that work for you, and actually in terms of the environment agency, just having the risk assessment and the support in terms of equipment or personal protective equipment or whatever it might be, to allow them to undertake that in safety. The thing we wouldn't want to do is leave them there as the residency in a point of danger. And that really responsibility lies with the environment agency. But they've assured me that they're very much on board with working together with communities, and it's part of the regional flood and coastal committee's strategy moving forward is about greater awareness and greater community engagement around managing flood risk. So it actually ticks all their boxes. It's just I'm not here to defend the environment agency, I'm a council officer, but in terms of the beginning of this year, they've been pretty much handling Storm Desert and Storm Eva, and they're only just coming out of that in terms of that work now.
Just going on from what Council Muspratt was talking about, I was going to ask a question about.
You don't have a mic, Chris, could you come down and speak just
a bit?
I'll be Tracy.
Just going on from what Council Muspratt was asking about the housing and the money that should be coming from the people who suffered from flooding and the weather, could you just tell what the criteria points are that weren't met to enable to have this? Because I think part of it is it's not a big enough area or a concentrated area of housing. My point would be that it does not feel within 100 houses or if you live in a cul-de-sac, 5 houses, if your house has been inundated with water. It's the same situation. So I was just wondering what points of the criteria weren't met that didn't enable them to have that money.
Because I'm signing on board right there, weren't you?
I'm almost inclined to say who knows is really the answer, because the criteria set about with what flooding support measures the government decided to give out, they gave it out to certain areas and they said required that funding. We made representation that we had nearly 100 properties that experienced internal flooding. That was raised by Andrew Eagle. They were written to in terms of DEFRA and the minister. And the answer we got back was that in the current position, those are not going to be considered part of the areas that are covered under that flood support measures.
Okay, sorry, Chair. Can I ask if it's being pursued?